Allah says in the Holy Quran, "Qul hal nunabbi'ukum bil aqsarina a'mala." Says, "O Muhammad, shall we inform you of the greatest losers as to their deeds?" Allah says, "Allatheena dalla sa'yuhum fil hayatid dunya wa hum yahsabuna annahum yuhsinuna sun'a." They are those whose effort is lost in worldly life, while they think that they are doing well in work. Did anyone have the meaning of it? Does anybody know the present situation of our community, of our ummah? Our ummah is in deep shatter and it's in complete mess. Because we all seem to be careless and we all are unaware of things. This is because ego. Ego has destroyed all of us. But we still feel that we are nawabs, right? Let me share one example with you all. This Ramadan, there was a picture in social network website in which it was depicted that there were Muslims at the bridge when it was newly inaugurated at 2 to 3 a.m. and it was quoted, "Musalmano ka bridge." Reading that, we all Muslims were like, "Oh, that's great, our bridge. We Muslims are at the peak. We have put so many efforts to reach this stage. And finally we reached that, isn't it?" But I'm sorry, it's not. Few weeks back, in Gujarat, Dalits were lynched by the mob. And after the lynching, Dalit leader said, "Don't think we are Muslims. We will not let you do injustice with us." I would like to repeat this point, ladies and gentlemen, please focus on that point. Don't think that we are Muslims. We will not let you do injustice with us. Actually, this was his wordings. And don't you think it's true? I personally feel it's true. And it's the present situation of our ummah. And who will change this? Somebody else? Christians? Buddhists? No. We have to change this mentality. We need to change this opinion about us from this world. And don't think we are alone. Allah is with all of us. We need somebody who can inspire us. We need one example to whom we can follow, right? We need a role model. Okay, I'll share my role model. He is a man whom I can give a title of the legend of the 21st century. I speak of today, brothers and sisters, of a man who haven't been given his credit and the praise which he deserves. Dr. Abdul Rahman, a Kuwaiti qualified doctor in the field of medicine and surgery, who qualified from the University of Baghdad. Then he pursued another diploma in the field of tropical diseases in the University of Liverpool. And then he went to complete his postgraduate studies in the McGill University of Canada, specializing in internal diseases and gastroenterology. Then he got married. Very well said by someone, "Behind the success of every man, there is a woman's hand." Just like that, Dr. Abdul Rahman's wife said, "You and I do not want to live average lives. We don't want to be like the average graduates. We were created for a very big cause. We have to do something else." Dr. Abdul Rahman replied, "I believe that now we should start people calling into the path of Allah." And then they both went to Africa continent with the sole intention of just building a masjid. Because Emir's wife gave a sum of money to Abdul Rahman to build a masjid in her name. He went to Africa. While the construction was going on, Dr. Abdul Rahman walked through the streets of Africa and he saw, and he was very depressed and shocked, that there Muslims didn't even know how to recite Surah Fatiha, don't know the Ark, five pillars of Islam, don't know the concept of Salah and Zakah. He saw idolatry at the peak and paganism at the climax. After seeing all this, he devoted his whole life, time, efforts, tears, wealth, just for the sake of Allah. My dear brothers, sisters, mothers and fathers, because of the shortage of time, I'll summarize his struggles. To go in the path of Allah, he had to go to a land, and for going to the land, there was a huge river, and he need to cross that river for going there, and because of inviting people to the path of Islam. That river was completely black, immense black, because of the feces, urine, filled infested with all types of excrement, lizards, and all types of diseases. You need to walk there. Believe me, if I would have been there, I would have never crossed that river. I would have gone back. But he was the man, he walked straight in the river. The water reached his throat, but he still moved on. He was asked for how much time were you there in the river? He said, for 4 hours. This is a doctor who has a degree in tropical diseases and he knows of the danger associated with doing that. But still he moved on. Not only this, but sometimes he needed to walk for 200 to 300 kilometers unpaved without any bicycle or some cars. He said at times 3 whole days passed and there wasn't anything to drink or to eat. A time when he was kneeling over looking into a particular pond that was filled with excrement and he was just trying to find a clean water just to quench the thirst, just to quench the dryness of his throat. Can you all imagine? He is finding like in the black river water. He's going in it. Can anybody do that? I can't. He speaks of very close encounters that he had with deadly cobras and each time Allah Almighty saving him through a miracle. He speaks of 2 assassinations attempts that were made on his life and twice he was imprisoned and became very, very close to executions. He spent around 30 years in the African continent doing everything that Allah has placed under his disposal. And now you guys will be amazed to know his achievements. After all his struggles, he built over 5,500 mosques. No less than 11 million people took shahada through him. Sponsored over 50,000 orphans, many of whom grew up to graduates to become doctors and lawyers. And did endless, endless, endless more things. This all didn't come through magic, supernatural power or something else. But this came at the expense of many tears that he had shed. Countless sleepless nights. This came at the expense of his worldly dreams and at the expense of his health. Now, don't you think that how selfish and careless we are as a Muslim community? When lakhs and lakhs of Rohingya Muslims are homeless, we are not doing anything, but we have the Christian, Sikhs and Buddhist community who care more and working at the ground zero to help them. It's sad and shame on us that we are not proactive in helping them. We as Muslims couldn't even come together to sort out our own triple talaq issue and we needed the BJP central government to sort out our religious issues or confusion. Isn't that bad? So, I would like to conclude my speech that if you want to change all this mentality, all what the world thinks about our community, first of all, just crush your ego and selfishness. Because the world has enough problems to solve and sort out. We, as the Muslim community, collectively have a lot to do. And let's set our goal and targets in improving ourselves individually first, and then we can collectively, as a Muslim community, do great things for the society, inshallah. Before I end up my speech, I would like to thank Rizwan sir and Jawir sir for your assistance, my class teacher for supporting me, my classmates and my bandmates for support, for motivating me, and least giving me this opportunity, my school. Thank you so much. Assalamu alaikum.